I joined MI5 in 1951. I joined the KGB in 1955. And after that, I worked for both of them.
The notorious spy, Russell Nicholson, talking to me near his home in northern Bulgaria.
From my point of view, it was a very good career move. It effectively doubled my chances of promotion.
For 28 years, Nicholson operated as a double agent, betraying countless British secrets to Soviet intelligence. By the time he was unmasked in 1983, the Russians had paid him something in excess of £750,000.
I don't think I did very much harm to Britain, really. I mean, on the plus side, look at all the foreign money I brought into the country.
This week, we talk to Russell Nicholson, his former friends and former colleagues, about his life, his work, and his defection to the East, in an effort to find an answer to the question, what makes a greedy, alcoholic degenerate turn bad?
Russell Nicholson, not ideological man. He not know what ideology mean. Not a word occur much in sex manual.
Well, people can attach loyalty to a variety of things, a country, a religion, a social class. Nicholson was loyal to his reproductive organs.
Well, for a start, nothing about that man is entirely straightforward. Even to this day, there remains a great deal of doubt about who Russell Nicholson was really working for. But then, of course, there's a great deal of doubt about who MI5 is really working for.
I've explained it all before. During the day, I work for the British. At night, I work for the Russians. At the weekend, I did the garden. It's as simple as that.
In 1962, Russell Nicholson married Mary Partridge. The couple was eventually divorced a year after his defection in 1983. What light can she cast on the riddle that is Russell Nicholson?
Well, it's no good asking me. For years, I thought his name was Cyril.
Are you saying that for 21 years he concealed his real identity from you?
Yes. He concealed a lot of things from me. It was ages before I found out we had a car. He used to park it round the corner and pretend he'd caught the bus. I don't know why, really. Of course, Cyril didn't
Russell.
Russell didn't need a reason to lie. He just did it automatically, almost as if he had to. I mean, sometimes if he was just popping out to the shops, he'd tell me he was going to engage in a night of unbridled passion with his mistress.
Did that bother you?
No. It was when he told me he was just popping out to the shops that I got worried.
Was he unfaithful to you, then?
Oh, yes. Often. I don't know why, really. And he wasn't very good at it, you know, sex.
Mm.
He did try, though, I'll give him that, but it was a case of a little and often.
Yes, so he didn't satisfy you?
Oh, no, absolutely not. It was terrible in bed, and in the hall, and on the kitchen table. He tried it everywhere, you know, but with him it wasn't so much the venue as the playing time. I suppose that's why he felt he had to do it so much, because on each occasion it was over so quickly.
Oh.
It wasn't as though I was jealous of all the other women, you know. I just resented them knowing how appalling my sex life was, that's all.
Yes, good. It was at about this time, wasn't it, that he started to persuade you to undertake missions for him?
Yes. Yes, he thought it would bring us closer together if I took more of an interest in his work, because obviously the sex wasn't doing it. It was always over far too quickly for there to be any time for any affection. So I did do a few trips to Moscow for him. I didn't like it much. It's very cold and the shops are terrible.
It was as a direct result of those trips to Moscow that you were found guilty of espionage and sent to prison for 1 year, wasn't it?
Yes, it was terrible. Still, it was a lot better than Moscow.
Looking back over it, Mrs. Partridge, do you feel bitter towards him at all?
Well, no, I mean, it's useless feeling bitter, isn't it? Of course, if he was here with you now, I'd kill him, obviously. But I'm not bitter, you know.
Yeah.
My wife's an extremely neurotic woman, Mr. Lander, extremely neurotic. There was nothing I could do about it.
Well, you could have stopped sending her on spying missions to Moscow.
Nonsense. It was good for her to get out of the house occasionally.
Why?
Well, saved her from the embarrassment of having to make small talk to my mistresses.
Why did you pretend to her that your name was Cyril?
Even in a marriage, I think there are always some things one should keep to oneself, don't you?
In many ways, Nicholson's career can be said to have started here, at Cambridge. For it was here, as an undergraduate in 1948, that he first met the brilliant but mercurial Bernard Knight. And it was here also that he was first recruited to MI5.
Well, the thing about Cambridge at that time was that, looking for jobs, one tended to do the milk round, you know, put out feelers to everyone, MI5, CIA, KGB, everyone. It's only if you got a second interview with two of them that problems could arise.
Did Nicholson have any pronounced political opinions at that time?
Oh, yes, strong ones. He was an extreme right-winger. He defended Hitler to me on numerous occasions. He said you got a completely different impression of the man when you realised that his speeches were supposed to be ironic.
If he was so right-wing, why did he join so many societies for left-wing intellectuals?
Oh, for the women. You see, most of the men in the left-wing societies at Cambridge were homosexuals. That meant there was much less competition for the women.
One such society that the undergraduate Nicholson joined was the Proselytes, a secret club ostensibly devoted to art and the intellect.
The Proselytes were a group of graduates and dons, who devoted themselves to the pursuit of truth, love and beauty, and having found them, to keeping them hidden from the rest of us.
Why?
Well, I think they felt we didn't deserve them. You see, the Proselytes, all of them, had this tremendous sense of moral superiority, which is surprising considering the morals that they had.
This man has been a member of the Proselytes ever since he went up to Cambridge in 1934. We've concealed his appearance partly because he wishes to remain anonymous and partly because he refused to wear any clothes.
The Proselytes are just another Cambridge University society. There's nothing sinister about us, nothing at all.
Why then, on joining, are you required to swear an oath of secrecy, the substance of which is that if you should break the oath, your bodily organs should be removed, cut into thin strips and delivered in a parcel to the Dean of St. Paul's?
Well, that's just a bit of harmless fun, isn't it?
Is it? I understand that for many years now, successive deans of St. Paul's have objected violently to the oath and implored you to change its wording.
Well, they're overreacting. It's purely symbolic. As far as I can remember, we've only done it once.
Russell Nicholson, Geoffrey King, and the man who was later to entice Nicholson into becoming a double agent, the mercurial Bernard Knight, were all recruited into MI5 at the same time.
Well, MI5 used to come round on the first Tuesday of each month and conduct interviews and give short illustrated lectures on their excellent facilities for skiing.
Why did they talk about their facilities for skiing?
Oh, it's the only part of the organisation that wasn't completely covered by the Official Secrets Act. Anyhow, one month, the three of us went along, queued up with the rest of the young hopefuls, and next thing you knew, we were in.
Of course, Bernard Knight by this time was already working for the KGB, wasn't he? But Nicholson wasn't recruited until later.
Yes, well, Nicholson was persuaded into it when he ran into money difficulties caused by his drinking.
He had the drink problem?
Oh, yes, right from the start. Occasionally, it used to interfere with his work. Sometimes he'd stagger into his office with his arm around the shoulder of the person he was supposed to be following.